I had the perfect childhood in the perfect place in the perfect country by the same perfect parents. And I look around me and I don't see other people having that opportunity. And I've had such a wonderful life that I say, I'm willing to fight you over taking away the opportunities that I had. My dad was a plant worker at DuPont. I grew up around plant workers, the kind of guys that punched the clock at 4 and were home at 4:12, changed shirts, coaching the Little League team, never missed a recital, never took a sick day, severe diabetic. And I say, that's a country where we loved our veterans, we loved our parents, we loved our grandparents, we listened to them, we were proud of our school, we didn't knife each other in the school, we didn't go to school afraid, and that dream. And we just kind of all took for granted that dream would always be there, and it's not. I am certain that just as a drug addict has to hit rock bottom in the streets to get help and fix it, just as a company has to restructure in court to come back out and be better, so too must our country. And I think we've hit that rock bottom. I watch everyday citizens who say, I'm not very political, now saying, by God, I am political. And then Portland, Oregon reached out. We weren't in any other markets. And they said, we want the Michael Barry Show in Oregon. And a senior radio official said, you don't want his show. It's too Southern fried. And that pissed me off. I did an event there 3 months ago. 1,000 people stood in line for 5 hours to shake my hand and get autographs. And they say, you're my hero. And I go, I'm just you. They hunt. They fish, they raise their kids, they work hard. When their back hurts, they get up and they still go to work. They don't take sick leave. They don't take government benefits. They still believe in America. And I want to get in there. I want to get in your heart and I want to twist it around. I want to get in your brain and knock around. And I want you uncomfortable. I want you to cry. I want you mad. And I want you to say, he can't say that, can he? But if I can do it with some humor following it up, I can make you think about things that were old habit to you.
Do you have a filter? The filter that a lot of people talk about, the word, they don't say X, Y, or Z. Do you have that filter?
Well, there's no filter. You see, I don't care that she has a big derriere. I care that she tells the rest of us that we can't, because she wasn't elected.
What about these other pockets of America? Jefferson County, for example, where people say, you just don't say that about a first lady.
I say things that other people feel like they can't, and I think it is so important that things be able to be said. You couldn't criticize Stalin or Hitler. I want it to be the case in this country that no matter who the president is and the first lady, even if they're black, that you be able to make reference to the size of their butt, how loud they are, how obnoxious they are. That is truly American.
Does he put on a little extra machismo for your average Texas listener?
Oh, sure. Yeah, sure. There are times where I lay it on a little heavier, but that's the way I lay it on when I'm entertaining my buddies at the bar, or my buddies are entertaining me at the bar. That's what we do. The truth is, I don't say anything that other people don't think and that guys don't say at their poker party.
Do you talk about race more than most?
I do talk about race more than most.
Why?
Race is not the problem. The inability to deal with public problems because of race is our biggest problem. We can't solve crime and drugs and violence and single motherhood because we might offend black people. Well, what's the bigger problem? Offending black people or imprisoning an entire generation of black people? It's got to be one or the other. I regret that sometimes in having some fun, I may have needled a person. I may have made a little light of them. And I didn't listen carefully to what their situation was at that time. And they may have called in about something, but they didn't do a good job. And so in my constant attempt to entertain, sometimes I'm not as kind as I could be. And I get off the air and I say, that could have been my mom or my dad. But part of the problem is entertainment and making you laugh is a big part of being effective with my message. Part of my problem is I've been an elected official. I've been a radio personality. My wife is now in public life. And I can go on the internet and hear things said about me, my wife, my children that would turn your stomach. So you develop a skin that is so thick. And people in public life do this. And so you forget that some people are very fragile. They're not used to their name being said publicly and they're the butt of a joke. So they don't learn to kind of take a joke. That's an acquired skill. So sometimes I think if I have a regret, it is that sometimes I should remember to be a little tender with people. But to me, that's boring radio. You tune in to watch me and whoever's in the middle of that arena, and you're the Roman Colosseum. You have a job to force conversations. And if I have to make myself the wedge in between you and the other person to force you to talk about things, then I do it. I'm just as happy if somebody disagrees with me as if they agree with me, as long as we're talking about the right things. And that's not who won American Idol. It is, what's the debt ceiling again? But I come from a regular Joe environment, and I love regular Joes, and I've tried to be the spokesman for regular Joes. But for me to pretend that would be ridiculous. I do very well financially. I live in a bubble world where people take care of my every need. I do, however, make sure that I stay connected to that guy, because that's the radio I'm providing. I'm not radio for corporate CEOs. I'm not radio for people that are used to radio. I'm radio for people that don't feel like they have a show.
How do you figure that 85% of these folks are welfare queens and crackheads?
Well, it might be 84 or 86, Kevin, but it's something in that range. I mean, the point is, you know, there's lies, damn lies, and statistics, so I figure they all run together.
Where's your stats for the 85?
Well, you spend enough time, you don't need to look it up. The truth is, boring essays and scholarly articles laying out the details of crime rates and single motherhood and drug dealing, that kind of stuff is not good radio. What I want to do is I want to pierce people. I want to pierce blacks as well as whites and Hispanics. When I get a minority caller who calls in and says, the first time I heard you and your accents and your stats and you're spouting things off and you're challenging people and you're talking rough, I thought, this guy is a racist, bad, evil person. But the longer I've listened, I go, you know, you're not saying anything Bill Cosby doesn't say. You're not saying anything Clarence Thomas doesn't say. I'm just not used to hearing a white guy say it. That gives me hope.
How can you talk rarely about your adopted African-American kids?
Sometimes people will attempt to defend me by saying, well, he can't be a racist because his kids are black. Your children don't have to be black for you to have useful opinions on race. And I want them to just kind of live their life. I want them to be my adorable, wonderful little kids. I don't want them to be some sort of a prop. So don't use that to defend me at all. My opinions on race are tough because I care about people and I watch what's happening in our country.
You care about people?
I do. I love people. But just like if you have children, you have to be tough with them, the same is true of society. I see a lot of people walking around having gone through sensitivity training and not offending anyone, but yet we're watching kids graduate from high school that can't read, they're going to prison, they're making babies they can't raise, and I say, I love you enough to get in your face. I love you enough to make you hate me before you love me. And that's what our parents did. How many of us loved our parents as teenagers?
Are conservatives not going to begin losing races because of division within the party?
Absolutely.
And what would be your role, if any, in that?
Well, you have to look at the Republican Party and what's happened in 08 and 12. The two most moderate Republican candidates we've put up since 96 with Dole, and notice we lost all three of those. There has to be the answer that we realize, A, we're losing, but B, I'm not passionate or loyal to the Republican Party. I'm passionate and loyal to this country and the people who are paying the dues, the people who are actually sending their sons to the wars that we keep involving ourselves that we shouldn't, the people who are paying these bills that we're taking debts for. And for those people, I say, I don't care about the Republican Party. I'll be a Democrat, a Republican, a Libertarian, or whatever it takes to fix this country. And there are a handful of people in a bigger, you know, figuratively, who've taken over this party and said, can't we all just get along? We're all getting along, but you're making all the decisions. And there are a lot of people who are frustrated in this country because they say, I know that I'm working harder and I'm being told I'm a bad guy. I know my kids are going to a school where they don't speak English anymore and I'm a bad guy. I know I go to the emergency room and I have to wait 12 hours when I got a gash that I'm bleeding to death from and I'm a bad guy. People are tired of being told they're a bad guy when they did nothing wrong. And when it's the Republican Party telling them that. I think the mood in the country is one of anger. I think there's an incredible amount of anger. I think there's an incredible amount of frustration. But I think you have to look at this. If I'm making $4 million a year and I have a limo driver.
Is that what you're making?
No.
You make $4 million
if
a year?
If I'm making $4 million bucks a year
what
and I've got
Does he make $2 million a year?
If I've got, you know, a limoed car, houses in multiple markets, I ski in Aspen, I summer in California. Look, the difference here and there, it's marginal, right? It's cheese on the burger or not. But when I'm at the bottom and I'm making 45 grand a year, and mama's staying home because she doesn't make enough to pay for daycare anyway, and we're struggling to keep it all together, And we're watching a president tell us that we can't drive a big truck because it takes too much gas. We can't turn our air conditioning on because we're killing the environment and we're eating too much when that's our one comfort in life. Yeah, I'm pretty darn mad. When you tell me that the sons and daughters of our families went off and served in war and came back missing an arm, and you refer to them bitterly clinging to guns and God, yes, I'm mad. And you're the president? Absolutely.
Well, you've called some African Americans stupid.
Yeah, a black person can be stupid too. Stupid is stupid. It doesn't matter if you're black.
I mean, elaborate.
We have this idea that because someone's black, they can't be a thug or stupid. Are useless or worthless. Yeah, absolutely you can. These are things we should get comfortable saying. If you gangbang, if you carjack people, if you make babies you don't raise, you're an idiot and our society has no use for you. And even if you're black, that's true.
700 years of institutionalized slavery have made many African Americans sensitive. 700 years of anything would make anybody sensitive. Are they wrong in that? Are they wrong to be sensitive about it?
Well, I mean, if we want to get into the business of comparative suffering, you know, we should at least spend some time on Jews and how beaten down they've been over the last few centuries. At least Shakespeare didn't criticize blacks in his poetry. I mean, he beat up on the Jews.
What about my beloved Irish?
Well, I think that at some point we have to decide as a country, and not just as black people. We have to decide as a country. What do we stand for? Do we stand for a colorblind society or don't we? And you can't have double standards and you can't mollycoddle people, particularly when the results have been broken families. Over 70% of black children born today are born into a home where there is no father. Well, he made that baby. What happened in the 9 months in between? We've had a breakdown of the social structure on a level we've never seen before. And this is going to perpetuate problems for generations, because we know when a kid's raised without a father, the likelihood of where he ends up 18 years later is not good. So this is going to require some radical changes, not sensitivity training.
They say that Michael Berry's going to be the next Rush Limbaugh because the country has changed. Rush Limbaugh maybe has changed. The national dialogue has changed. What do you say to that when you hear
that? I'm not the next Rush Limbaugh. Rush Limbaugh is Rush Limbaugh. He is a very, very special man who came along at a very special time, and I'm mindful that there would not be national talk radio the way there is today but for him and his time. He understands entertainment in a way that every day for 3 hours he has a university class where the whole nation gets to watch for free. And because he can be entertaining, because he can be this sort of supposedly very arrogant person, because he can put on this air, it keeps you entertained. Because he can joust at people and kind of needle them a little bit, he can keep this interesting. But what he's done, for the length of time he's done, the breadth of influence he's had, it's amazing. And I don't want to be that. I tell people every day, I'm not that. I want to be the guy that corporate CEOs and private jet folks listen in because they want to know what real people are thinking. I want to be the one bastion, the one place, the one incubator of real, honest conversation where blacks and whites and Hispanics and men and women and old people and young people talk about things in the way that we really talk about them. Because let's be honest, we could turn off that camera and you and I'd cuss, I don't know if you would, we'd start telling some jokes, we'd start goofing around. But we're not going to talk that way in public, right? So I want to have that conversation because there's some honesty in that. I don't really consider myself a conservative. I consider myself much more on the end of the spectrum of libertarian.
Nobody believes that Michael Berry.
I'm much more radical than any conservative. I don't want the government telling you who you can sleep with, what time you should go to bed, and what you can put up your nose. That's not my business. I want government out of all of our lives. And regardless who you are, and I think that there's a growing movement of that.
I'm sorry. Would you support legalizing marijuana in the state of Texas?
Absolutely. Yeah.
You'd support that.
Yeah.
Would you your views on same-sex marriage policy has differed dramatically from many conservatives?
I think that state law is in the business of sanctioning marriage or not, and as long as we are. The state of Texas says we don't want to sanction gay marriage, and that should be the policy, and that shouldn't be a Washington, D.C. policy.
Where does Michael Berry come down on?
To me, marriage is between a man and a woman. If two gay guys want to take up whatever that's their business. But to me, marriage is between a man and a woman.
I've heard you many times when a caller called in and made reference where they seem to support the idea of marriage between a man and a woman. It almost sounded as if you pulled them back from the precipice.
No, I think what's happened is the Republican Party, there are some people who consider themselves Republicans who just don't like gay people. They don't want them out there. They're creepy, they're weird, they're sissified. We don't want them around. Well, every gay person should be a Republican. Because if you talk to 10 gay people, you'll find out they share the same values that every Republican does. Less government out of their lives, leave them alone, leave them to their privacy, leave them to what they do when they're off from work. When's the last time you met a gay person that was on welfare? You don't. They tend to be self-reliant people. So just because I don't think they should be married in the state of Texas doesn't mean that I want to bash them. And sometimes people want all or nothing. I hate them gay people. They ought not get married and they ought not be alive. Well, that's too far.
Too much bashing.
Yeah, believe it or not, I'm a moderate there. See,
you're a moderate in that, and yet you referenced the legend of Billy Jack. So how moderate could you be?
Well, you know, I try to make a lot of pop culture references because at the end of it, I'm not, you know, the PhD in political theory. This is a conversation where we may talk about chicken fried steak or how my grandmother made her skillet cornbread. It's 3 hours and then later 2 hours of us hanging out, and we're just talking. We're talking about what we're going through. I talk about testosterone replacement, which I'm on because I'm 43. I'm noticing I don't have the energy I did. I talk about how much is too much to drink. I talk about whether we ought to be on our cell phones when we're out as a family. Politics is a very small part of what I talk about, and that's what's different than our show and most, because I really want this to be a place that for 5 hours a day, you can come in and out of the show, and who knows what we'll be talking about, because that's how you are. That's how I am.
You gonna run for office?
No, I've run for office. I've won. I've lost.
Statewide office.
No, absolutely not. No, I've done it. I love it. It's for other people. It's not for me. I can get a lot more done here.
Why is it for other people?
It's for other people who can't do what I do. I have a very unique skill, and I don't think there are more than a dozen people in the country that have the skill I have. And this is where I'm meant to be at this point in my life.
But what is that skill?
I have the ability to bring in people who are not engaged in what's going on in the country, but they know something's wrong, and I have the ability to have a conversation in a way that they connect and in a way that makes them realize I have a civic duty. But I also can do something on talk radio that I don't think anybody can do. I can make you a better parent. I can make you a better neighbor. I can make you a better person. I can make it so that people, when a veteran walks into a Starbucks, 10 people rush to pay his bill for him because he's in uniform. I don't know if anybody else can do that. Those are the things that I measure my pride in, not electoral victories.
How much does it concern you when you look at Jimmy the Greeks and some very prominent Americans who have referenced race at various times and ended up quite honestly losing their careers? You know, over it. Ever think, man, one of these days, man.
No fear. The minute I have fear is the minute it's over. We're strapped in, we're 100 miles an hour. But you have to understand, we have built, we call them the Barry Brigade, we have built listeners who understand, hey, look, if you and I get in an argument, at some point I'm going to cuss you out. And so I have the equivalent of that on the air. I have moments where I'm raging, I'm so mad, I'm furious. How could they say this about the American people? I don't get angry personally because I'm doing great. I get angry on behalf of veterans. When a veteran dies in Afghanistan, when a soldier dies in Afghanistan and his family doesn't get a letter, happened in Houston, for 6 months afterward, and it's a form letter with a form stamp, I get furious. And I'll say things that I probably ought not say. And if it ever comes a time that I'm kicked off because of that, any station and any group of listeners that wouldn't cut me some slack for one stupid statement, they didn't have a depth of engagement enough that I deserved or they deserved me. And that's just how I look at it. If I could be kicked off for one stupid statement, then I wasn't in a very good position anyway. Because you don't divorce your wife or kick your kids out of the house because of one dumb statement. Funny, we were in New York and Oregon and Atlanta and Nashville and Birmingham and Baton Rouge before we were on in Beaumont. And it was sort of like coming home. And so it is rewarding when I get emails from people I went to school with and they go, hey, Michael, I hear you on the radio.
So this humble servant of the Lord from Orange, Texas would turn down Cumulus if they came calling.
Absolutely, yeah.
And wanted to do a national radio show.
Absolutely, yeah. Yeah. I will do it. If I do it, I'll do it on my terms, and I will own it. Because radio executives are people who failed at radio, typically. And so they're the people who tell you they want to serve Big Macs. I don't want to serve Big Macs.